Hello student, I am Professor Smita Singh, the professor of home science subject in OSN Academy. Now this is a very important moment for all of us because we are giving you a live classes on Pan India level with collaboration with top rankers. This UGC examination is supposed to be a very important and a prestigious, and of course it's a very tough examination which can yield so many assistant professors for the universities, or you can go with the research scholars. But with proper guidance and proper study materials and the techniques will help you to crack this UGC NET examination very, very easily. We are two professors for home science subject. I am Professor Smita Singh and the other one is Professor Neha Sinha. We both will help you to give you a live classes and prepare yourself for this examination, to crack this examination this year in fact. This demo classes will start off with the first unit of UGC NET's home science syllabus, and the first chapter is food science and nutrition. Now first we'll just look about what is food science. Simple. Study of a food is called food science. Now there are various institutes which define this food science. The Institute of Food Technologists defines the food as a big discipline in which you can have the engineering ka part aap dekhenge, the biological part, all the biological aspects, the physical science to study the actual study or the nature of food, and of course the causes of deterioration, kaise wo spoil kar raha hai. There are some other simple definitions, and the simple textbook of food science actually defines this food science in a very simple term, which is the application of actual basic science and engineering to study the what? The physical, chemical, biochemical, all the aspects of your food, and which will help in different food processing. Now this is the food science. And what is the nutritional science? Nutritional science is a big umbrella, you may say. And big umbrella which is saying that food science comes into the nutritional science. Nutritional science can be a study of your food, your eating, and your health, or the medicines which will affect your health. So whatever the food content which helps to affect your body's health is called nutritional science. So you can say it's a multifaceted field. That is, actually it is the chemistry. You have to look for the chemistry also. You have to look for the biological aspects or the biology, and also very important is the social sciences, which have many area of specialization. So nutritional science is not only the science, but it is actually a behavior and the social factors which is always related to your food choices. So it is a very broad, a big umbrella where you can look for the food. You have to study about the food, you have to study about your wellness, of course the community, where the different aspects have been taken, like nutritional deficiencies. You have to look for that also. You have to study on that aspects also. That is a community nutrition. Exercise science also comes in this nutrition science, and also giving nutrition education to those who don't know what is nutrition and why is it important for you all. So you can say that these are the two parameters which works on your health, and it actually emphasizes on its impact, or are very different. Now let's talk about food. You may say that there's a nutrition science can be, you can define it in a different way. It is basically your biological, chemical, and social and psychological factors, and food science is just to study your food, the nature of the food, and how it can be spoiled so that it can help you in different manufacturing and processing industries. Now we know about food science, we know about nutrition science. Now let's talk about simple food, because food is a important and the center point where we have to study in each and every aspects of the food. Food, it helps you to in your health aspects. Food, which is good for your not to get disease or infected. Food to get your immune system strong. So we have to look about the food content. So you should know about what is food. Now you can say that food can be a simple or anything which is solid or liquid. When you are taking it and it get digested in your body, it get assimilated and also it is getting absorbed for your body to get healthy. You can also define it as anything eaten, drunk, or which can be absorbed in the body, which is used for your energy. You can, and because there are various functions of the food which you have to look for why we are eating the food. So why we are eating the food? We are eating for our different three big functions. That is what? Which is what? The first one is energy giving. The second one is bodybuilding. And the third one is giving yourself a immune to fight back with different diseases or infections. So food provides you energy for various involuntary and voluntary tasks. Now, what are voluntary tasks and what are involuntary tasks? Do you know any about? Do you know the difference? Yes, I think so. Many of the people know about what is voluntary and what is involuntary. Voluntary means what? Which you are doing things when you are conscious. And what is involuntary task? Your mechanism, which you are not having any control. You can't control yourself to have that mechanism, like respiration. You don't have any control. You just can stop breathing for just for few seconds or few minutes, but you can't stop it the whole way. You can't stop your digestion system. You can't stop your circulation system. So these are your involuntary task. And voluntary task, like I'm talking or I'm listening or I'm writing it down. So these are things which we are having a control. So this is voluntary and involuntary. So for all these tasks, you need to have some energy. And where we get the energy? We get the energy from food, right? Second, the most important is the growth or repairment or building materials. You can say body building materials. And what are these body building materials? They are all the body, you must be saying that all the body fluids, all the body cells are actually made up of proteins. Right? So proteins are the most important nutrient which will help you to give a good growth or maintenance or repairing any of the cells which have been damaged every now and then. The third is also a very important function of food, which is materials to fight back any of the disease or regulate your organ systems. Because your body always have an immune system for various functions. So you have to look care about the things. Now, in this session only, I'll talk about one more thing, that is basal metabolism rate. That is what? BMR. What is this BMR? It is actually energy. You may say that when you are in resting stage, when you're in resting stage, whatever the things are getting down in your body, inside your body is whenever the what I told about you, that is what is involuntary muscles, involuntary task, which are even not controlled in your hand. So what are the whatever the involuntary tasks are going on, they need some energy. And at the energy which has been used for this involuntary task in your resting stage is called metabolism rate. It's called the basal metabolism rate. And what is this resting stage? Resting stage can be defined as after 12 years of 12 hours of your ingestion of any of the food. After 12 hours, because whenever you eat the food, your digestive system get activated, and they got start getting different digestion system. Digestive system absorption होता है, assimilation होता है, तो ये सब कुछ एक साथ चलता रहता है. तो इट्स नॉट अ रेस्टिंग स्टेज. तो जब 12 आवर्स कंप्लीट डाइजेशन कंप्लीट हो चुका होता है, तब जो इनवॉलेंट्री वर्क्स हो रहे होते हैं, दैट इज योर रेस्टिंग पीरियड. एंड रेस्टिंग पीरियड में जो एनर्जी यूज होती है वो काउंट करते हैं हम लोग बेसल मेटाबॉलिज्म रेट. सो इनवॉलेंट्री मसल, जैसे इनवॉलेंट्री प्रोसेस, जैसे हम कैसे कहते हैं मेटाबॉलिज्म, एनी ऑफ द मेटाबॉलिज्म विच इज डन बाय रेस्पिरेशन, सर्कुलेशन, ग्लैंडुलर एक्टिविटीज एंड ऑल्सो टू मेंटेनेंस ऑफ एनी ऑफ योर मसल बोन्स. सो दिस इज द बेसिक बेसल मेटाबॉलिज्म रेट. यू कैन मेजर इट एज एनर्जी यूज पर यूनिट ऑफ बॉडी वेट पर यूनिट ऑफ टाइम, और यू कैन से किलो कैलोरीज पर किलोग्राम्स बॉडी वेट पर आर, और यू कैन से दैट इट इज द बेसल मेटाबॉलिज्म रेट. नो देर आर वेरी वेरियस फैक्टर्स विच इफेक्ट्स योर बी एम आर. द फर्स्ट वन इज द एज. वेन यू आर यंग, स्पेशली एट द 2 years ऑफ एज, इट हैज द हाइएस्ट बी एम आर, बिकॉज at 2 years your metabolism rate has been increased very very much. इसीलिए आप कहते हो जब छोटा बच्चा जब walk करता है या run करता है या कोई activity करता है, they don't get tired easily, they don't get fatigue. So because their BMR is very high at young age, but as the age increases your lean bone body mass is decreases, and what will happen, the adipose tissue increases, and this will actually been helpful in reducing your BMR. The BMR decreases by 2% per decade after 21 years of age. So after 21 years of age, this 2% is a reduction of BMR. This question has came in one of your early examination of UGC NET. So you should know about percentage, how much percentage has been taken care. The next factor is the gender. Females have less lean bone body mass, and so they have higher fat percentage, and thus there's 5% lower BMR than men. But males have less fat percentage, so their BMR has been increased. The young adult of a young adult male contains almost 14% of fat, and the young adult female actually gets 32% of fat. And after 45 years of age, there's a reduction in hormones and there's a drop in BMR. The next factor is your body size and surface area. About 80% of your energy comes from your fat and glucose, which is actually lost as a heat. Now 15% of the heat is lost from your skin, and the remaining heat loss comes from your lungs and other excretory matters. This is the reason we say that large and tall people have very high BMR than lean and short people, because they have a very higher surface area and muscle content. The next important factor is your physiological condition. If you are pregnant, your BMR has been increased, and BMR in first trimester decreases due to there's a very low fetal activity, but it increases in other trimesters. There's an average of 20% increment has been observed. The next one is the lactation period. Now compared to the pregnancy, this BMR actually falls down during a lactation period, and because at this period there's no tissue synthesis and there's only milk synthesis, so your body is not working much, it's just doing work for your milk synthesis. The next factor is the stress. Okay, so if your body is getting, you're not stressed in the not in the form of stressful condition, but your hormones have been increased when you are stressed, like epinephrine or norepinephrine, which affects your actually cellular BMR. And one more thing, that is whenever you are in a hyperketabolic conditions, like when you are getting fever or burn or accident, in all the these conditions, what happens? Your cells has to be synthesized further to come back from this all the conditions like burn or any of the accidents. In that case also, your BMR has been increased. The next one is the endocrine glands. Now, hyperactivity of any of the endocrine glands can increase your BMR, and also it can be like hyperactivity can what it happens? It can reduce your metabolism rate. So if the endocrine glands have, you have to look for the endocrine glands activities. The next one is the sleep. Now this question has also come in the early examinations, like how much BMR has been reduced. That is like it is like 7 to 10% reduction in normal sound sleep. There is a 7 to 10% reduction in BMR. The next one is the temperature. Now in low environmental temperature, what it happens? You start shivering, and when you shiver, you generate some energy, and when you generate energy, there is an increase in BMR. Now this process is actually known as cold induced thermogenesis. You will see that infants doesn't shiver much because they have brown adipose tissue in addition to the white adipose tissue. And when you get fever, there in fact an elevation in the body temperature about above 37 degree or 98.4 degree increment, there is an increment of metabolism rate by 13% for each Celsius and 7% for each Fahrenheit. So you have to look for the examination. There is a question, I think so, previous year only, in 2018, there was question which asks you that how much there is an increment of a metabolism rate in your per degree Celsius. So you have to look for the how, what is this for per degree Celsius? It will be 13%, and if you are looking for the Fahrenheit, you have to look for the answer question. Which is the questions which are coming? You're coming with which question? Is it Celsius or the Fahrenheit? If it's coming with the Fahrenheit, then you have to look for 7%. So you have to look for the questions even ki which you have to in fact read the question very carefully for it. The next factor is your pharmacological agents. Now there are various medicines which actually boost your immune system, and it will increase your metabolism. So your metabolism, your basal metabolism rate also increases. There are some sedatives like amphetamines and any of the sedatives which will decrease your BMR. There are some nicotines and caffeines which increases your energy expenditure, and so your BMR has been increased. There are some beta blockers also which is used to treat your hypertension and may lead to a slight decrease in energy expenditure, and hence there's a tendency to gain weight. Then and one more factor, that is state of nutrition. Now after a very prolonged calorie undernutrition, BMR may fall to at least 20 to 30% below your normal level. So this is actually saying that their body's adaptive effort to conserve energy, because you are not having much of food or you are getting deficiency of any disease, for in that case your BMR has been getting down. BMR is actually affected by food consumption, and overfeeding can increase your BMR by 5 to 10%, while underfeeding can reduce your BMR. So those people who want to reduce their weight, they have to increase their BMR, and if they are in fasting, then their metabolism rate will be getting down, and again they won't be able to reduce the weight. The next factor is the smoking. When habitual smokers stop smoking, what it happens? They have a tendency to gain weight. When you must be seeing that जो चेन स्मोकर्स होते हैं, एकदम से उसने बंद किया अपना स्मोकिंग, तो दे गेन वेट बिकॉज दिस निकोटिन विच आई हैव टोल्ड यू बिफोर इज एक्चुअली इंक्रीजेज योर बीएमआई बाय 10%. द नेक्स्ट फैक्टर इज योर साइकोलॉजिकल फैक्ट स्टेट. एंड वेन यू आर एंजाइटी, वेन यू आर एंशियस, योर एपिनेफ्रिन सिक्रीशन इज मोर एंड दिस विल एक्चुअली इंक्रीजेज योर मेटाबॉलिज्म रेट. The last one is your last one factor is your disease processes. Now, metabolic rate increases in fever, tumors, or burns to the skins. And why? Because there's a mechanism which involves intracellular signaling agents such as cytokines, and which will increase your metabolism rate. So for this, other parameters are also been taken care of. That is how your by with this BMR only we can classify the activity of any of the humans, like heavy workers which are carrying heavy loads, food cutting or stone cutting, they are coming in the heavy workers. The second one is the moderate worker, like simply walking or shoemaking. And the last one is the sedentary, who are just sitting down and having the things. So the scale given below can be nutritional work in India, and you can say that the calorie requirement of any of the average adult which is taking care of either heavy worker, they are coming under heavy worker or moderate worker or sedentary workers, they all have the different calories and nutrient requirements according to the BMR. This session, we just come up with the end of the session, and in our next session, we'll talk about different recommended dietary allowances for each and every different activities of the people. Thank you so much.
गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम प्रोफेसर नेहा सिन्हा. अभी आपने फूड साइंस एंड न्यूट्रिशन की क्लास ली थी और इसके बाद हम आज आपसे बात करेंगे टेक्सटाइल्स के बारे में. तो स्टूडेंट्स, सबसे पहले अगर हम बात करते हैं टेक्सटाइल के बारे में, सो व्हाट हम सबसे पहले हमारे दिमाग में क्या आता है, व्हाट कम्स इन आर माइंड व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट टेक्सटाइल्स. सो द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट कम्स इन आर माइंड व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट टेक्सटाइल्स इज जो कपड़ा हम पहनते हैं, राइट. व्हाट एवर क्लॉथ दैट वी आर वेयरिंग इज द टेक्सटाइल. एवरीबॉडी, ये तो चीज है ना जो कि सबको ही पहनता है. सो लेट्स टॉक अबाउट, सबसे पहले हम बात करते हैं कि वो कपड़ा किस यूनिट से बनता है. व्हाट इज द यूनिट दैट दिस क्लॉथ और एनी फैब्रिक इज मेड ऑफ. सो इट इज मेड ऑफ द फाइबर. फाइबर कैन बी डिफाइंड एज एनी प्रोडक्ट विच इज केपेबल ऑफ बींग वोवन और मे बी मेड इन टू अ फैब्रिक. आइदर आप उसको निट कर सकते हैं, जैसे कि हम स्वेटर्स निट करते हैं, बिन सकते हैं, या फिर उसका हम फैब्रिक बना सकते हैं. सो इट इज द स्मॉलेस्ट विजिबल यूनिट ऑफ द टेक्सटाइल प्रोडक्ट. सो इफ एनीबॉडी आस्क व्हाट अ फाइबर इज, इट इज द स्मॉलेस्ट विजिबल यूनिट ऑफ द टेक्सटाइल प्रोडक्ट. इट इज हेयर लाइक स्ट्रैंड विच इज वेरी स्मॉल इन डायमीटर, and when it is compared to its length the diameter is really very small. ठीक है, it is pliable in nature, मतलब आप उसको weave कर सकते हैं. they can be called as the fundamental unit in making textile yarns and later on into its fabrics. so now let's talk about what a yarn is. yarn, तो जब हम बात करते हैं व्हाट अ यार्न इज, व्हाट इज अ यार्न, कोई बता सकता है मुझे? हाँ, तो यार्न इज अ स्ट्रैंड ऑफ फाइबर्स. इन्हीं फाइबर्स का जब हम स्ट्रैंड लेते हैं एक से ज्यादा, इट इज अ स्ट्रैंड ऑफ फाइबर्स विच इज आइदर लेड डाउन टुगेदर और मे बी ट्विस्टेड टुगेदर बाय अ प्रोसेस कॉल्ड स्पिनिंग। तो तब जब स्पिन करके बनाते हैं, जब इन फाइबर्स को जब हम स्पिन कर लेते हैं तो इनका यार्न बन जाता है। तो यार्न्स भी बहुत तरीके के होते हैं, सिंपल यार्न, कॉम्प्लेक्स यार्न, नॉवेल्टी यार्न भी उनको बोलते हैं कॉम्प्लेक्स यार्न्स को, फिर टेक्सचराइज्ड या टेक्सचर्ड यार्न्स होते हैं, इसके बारे में हम आपको बाद में बताएंगे। सबसे पहले हम जो है सिर्फ और सिर्फ जनरल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ ऑल फाइन स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ टेक्सटाइल फाइबर्स के बारे में बताएंगे। सो सबसे पहले जब हम क्लासिफिकेशन करते हैं टेक्सटाइल का, तो फाइबर्स को जब हम क्लासिफाई करते हैं तो हम तीन मेन यूनिट में इसको क्लासिफाई करते हैं, ठीक है। तीन मेन यूनिट जो हम इसको क्लासिफाई करते हैं वो होता है, एक होता है आपका नेचुरल और एक होता है मैनमेड फाइबर। पहले हम नेचुरल और मैनमेड फाइबर के बारे में बात करते हैं, बाकी के जो डिफरेंशिएशन है उसके बारे में हम बाद में करेंगे। पहले नेचुरल फाइबर क्या होता है इसके बारे में बात करते हैं। तो नेचुरल फाइबर्स क्या हो जाते हैं, आपका जो आपको नेचर से फाइबर्स मिल रहे हैं, यानी कि किसी भी पेड़ के फ्रूट से मिल रहा हो वो फाइबर, या फ्रूट के शेल से मिल रहा हो फाइबर, या फूड के सीड, जो भी आपका पेड़ है उसके सीड के हेयर से मिल रहा हो वो फाइबर, तो वो आपका नेचुरल फाइबर में आ जाता है। तो नेचुरल फाइबर्स को भी हम तीन हिस्सों में डिवाइड करते हैं। पहला हो जाता है आपका वेजिटेबल फाइबर, दूसरा हो जाता है आपका एनिमल, और तीसरा हो जाता है मिनरल। तो जब हम प्रॉपर्टीज के बारे में बात करते हैं तो नेचुरल फाइबर्स जो है वेजिटेबल, एनिमल और मिनरल में भी उसको फर्दर हम डिफरेंशिएट कर सकते हैं। सो व्हाट कम्स इनटू नेचुरल फाइबर्स दैट आर ऑफ वेजिटेबल सोर्स, फर्स्ट लेट्स टॉक अबाउट दैट। फर्स्ट इज योर कॉटन, कॉटन के कपड़े तो एवरीबॉडी वेयर्स कॉटन, राइट। सो फर्स्ट इज योर कॉटन, देन व्हाट ऑल कम्स, लिनन इज अ वेजिटेबल फाइबर, कापोक इज अ वेजिटेबल फाइबर, जूट इज अ वेजिटेबल फाइबर, एंड हेम्प इज ऑल्सो अ वेजिटेबल फाइबर। ऑल द प्रोसेसिंग ऑफ द वेजिटेबल फाइबर्स और एनिमल फाइबर्स ऑलवेज कम्स इन द एग्जाम्स। So we will be talking about the individual processing of all the fibers later on. But first we will study the basic classification. So in the vegetable fibers, I told about cotton, linen, kapok, hemp and jute. Next we talk about animal fibers. So can anybody tell me what all comes in animal fibers? Yes, silk and wool are main examples of animal fibers because they are cultivated from animals. Wool is cultivated from the sheep and silk is cultivated from a fiber made from the caterpillar which is known as Bombyx mori. So we will talk about that later on. The third fiber is the asbestos, which is the mineral fiber that comes in the natural fibers. Now let's talk about the man-made fibers. First is the regenerated cellulose. Regenerated cellulose. Examples of regenerated cellulose are cupramonium, viscose rayon, and nitrose cellulose rayon, and many such examples. There is another man-made fiber which is called synthetic fiber. Synthetic fiber. Example of synthetic fiber is polyester rayon and nylon and acrylic. And the third classification of man-made fibers is the acetate cellulose fiber. Acetate cellulose fiber. And the example what we can give in the acetate cellulose fiber is the nylon. So students, let's first talk about what vegetable fibers are. So fibers which are derived from plants as are known as the vegetable fibers, like I told you. Now, what are the fibers? See, from the plants, whether you're talking about the stem or whatever you're taking the fiber from, it is basically made up of elements like carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. These fibers have certain properties like low resilience, high density, and they are really good conductors of heat. They are highly absorbent, like cotton is a highly absorbent material, right? So they are highly absorbent and resistant to high temperatures. Examples like cotton, flax, and jute are examples of vegetable fibers. We next come to the animal fibers. Like I told you, they are obtained from animals. They are made up of, since they are obtained from animals, they are made up of protein molecules. Now, here the basic elements of these animal fibers will be carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. They also have high resilience, but they are weak when wet. So when you wet them, jab aap usko bhigate hain, they are weak, they become weak. And because they are bad conductors of heat, they are bad conductors of heat. Is sub property ke bare mein hum abhi batayenge. We come to mineral fibers. They are inorganic materials which are shaped into fibers, and they are mainly used for fireproof fabric, because asbestos, like I told you, which comes into the mineral fibers, it is called, the asbestos was generally called as inextinguishable, yani jisko bujhaya na ja sake. So they are basically fireproof fabrics are made up of asbestos, which is a mineral fiber. They are also resistant to acids and they are used for industrial purposes. We also come to the man-made fibers. Inki hum general mein bata dete hain. Those which are made by man aur jo ki naturally occurring nahi ho. They are not present naturally, but they are made by man, are the man-made fibers. These man-made fibers have high strength. They are very strong when wet. They have low moisture absorption characteristics also. We now come to the general properties of all fibers. So first of all, we'll talk about the staple fibers and filament fibers, ki what the staple fibers are and what these filament fibers are. So staple fibers, chahe wo natural ho, chahe man-made ho, either they can be either natural or man-made, but those are fibers which are short in length. They are very short fibers, between 3/4 of an inch to somewhere around 18 inches. So students, except silk, all other natural fibers are staple fibers. Silk is a very long filament, but except for silk, all natural fibers are short or staple fibers. Next we come to filaments. What are filaments? Staple was short fibers, filaments are long fibers. So long continuous fibers, and they are strands of basically indefinite length, which are measured not in centimeters, not in inches, but they are measured in yards and meters, are filaments. So natural silk fiber, like I told, is somewhere around 360 to 1200 meters long. Can you imagine, वो छोटा सा caterpillar जो होता है, जो silkworm होता है, वो कितना लंबा silk का fiber निकालता है, है ना? So it is 360 to 1200 meters long. Synthetic fibers, तो हम क्योंकि, because they are being made by man, so they can be made into kilometers and kilometers. So length is not a problem in synthetic or man-made fibers. Now, whenever we go out and whenever we go to buy a cloth, I would like to ask you, what is the first thing that you see in the cloth? आप जब कुछ भी खरीदने जाते हैं, जब shopping करने जाते हैं, अपने लिए आपको कपड़ा खरीदना होता है, तो आप बताइए, आप सबसे पहले क्या देखते हैं? उस कपड़े का रंग देखते हैं या उस कपड़े का कुछ property कुछ तो आता होगा जो आप सबसे पहले देखते हैं? Texture. हम उस कपड़े का फील लेते हैं, है ना, हम उसको हाथ में लेके देखते हैं, वी टच इट बाय हैंड एंड वी फील हाउ स्मूथ और हाउ रफ द टेक्सचर इज. ओके, सो टेक्सचर इज अ प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ द फाइबर. सो व्हाट इज टेक्सचर? द टैक्टाइल सेंसेशन और टच एक्सपीरियंस्ड बाय आर हैंड विच इज आइदर रफ और मे बी स्मूथ इज कॉल्ड द texture of the fabric. So it will be rough for fabrics which are made out of staple fibers or short fibers, and it will be smooth for fabrics made up of long fibers or filaments. So for textures you can say that staple fibers, because they are short in length, they have a rough texture, and filaments have a very smooth texture. Next we come to the second property, which is known as the resilience. Resilience is the resistance to compression for different fibers. So the resilience or the resistance to compression varies between different fibers. Some has good resilience, some fibers are very bad resiliency. So this is the quality for that is judged when wrinkles. When we have to buy cloth, we see कि किसी में बहुत जल्दी जो है वो चूर तो नहीं हो रहा, it does not have much of wrinkles. So this is the quality which is checked for wrinkles and all. So if you look at wool, wool has high resiliency, and if you look at cotton, cotton has low resiliency, and this resilience is also known as loft, LOFT, loft. Next we come to luster. Luster, basically what is luster? It is the shine. Whenever we see the fabric, we see whether the fabric, if we want to go out for a sober fabric, then we will see that it should not be much shiny. But once we are buying something that we need to buy in, wear in parties, or maybe you know shiny texture, then we see the luster of the fabric. So what is luster? The property of fabric to reflect light from its surface is called luster. Now, for example, which fabric has good luster? Tell me. Silk. Silk has a good reflection of light. So synthetics and silks have high luster, and sometimes the luster is so much in fabrics that it has to be removed during spinning. Okay. Next, we talk about the electricity. Have you ever felt while taking off a woolen cloth or maybe a woolen sweater ki ekdam se chat chat karke awaazein aayi ho aur laga ho ki jaise electricity nikli ho? All of you must have felt that, I'm sure. Jab specially jab garmi aur thanda ke beech ka wo time hota hai, to us samay jab hum garam kapda nikalte hain to chingari si nikalti hai. So that is the static electricity which is created by the friction of a fabric when it is rubbed against either itself or any other object. So that is the static electricity, and this static electricity is more during hot and humid conditions. We come to the next point, next property, which is the crimp. Crimp ka matlab kya hota hai? Jabhi bhi hum wool khareedte hain, specially because wool ek aisa hai jiska hum यान फाइबर हम देख सकते हैं, तो जब हम वुल खरीदते हैं तो आप देखते हो कि वुल जो है थोड़ा कर्वी सा होता है, तो ये जो उसकी ये जो वेवी वाली प्रॉपर्टी होती है वुल की, द वेवीनेस ऑफ अ फैब्रिक इज नोन एज इट्स क्रिम्प, एंड वुल हैज क्रिम्प्स. द फाइनर द वुल, जितना फाइन होगा वुल, द मोर विल बी द क्रिम्प्स इन इट, उतनी ही अच्छे उसमें वो क्रिम्प्स होंगे. सो what property does it give to the fabric, crimping, or maybe the crimps that are there in wool? What property it gives to the fabric? It gives elasticity to the fiber. Jab aap kabhi wool ko khichega aise to curved wavy wavy rehta hai, but when you pull it, it comes back. So that is the elastic nature of the fiber, and that is what we will be discussing now. So what is elasticity? The ability of a stretched material to return back to its normal size is called as its इलास्टिसिटी, जैसे कि रबर बैंड को जब हम खींचते हैं, व्हेन वी पुल अ रबर बैंड इट एक्सपैंड्स, बट देन व्हेन वी रिलीज इट इट कम्स बैक टू इट्स नॉर्मल साइज, दैट इज द इलास्टिसिटी, एंड द सेम अप्लाइज टू एनी फैब्रिक, सो दैट इज ऑल्सो अ प्रॉपर्टी. नाउ लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ फैब्रिक्स ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ देयर लेंथ एंड and therefore we can classify them into filaments and staple yarns. I have told you, let's talk about monofilament yarn. What is a monofilament yarn? It is a man-made fiber which is composed of a single filament which is extruded to the diameter which is desired for the yarn. The people, they take it and they make it a filament into their desired diameter, whichever diameter they require and whichever length they require, they make it, and that is known as the monofilament yarn, and these yarns are stiff in nature. Okay, now we will talk about the bicomponent fibers. What are bicomponent fibers? It is made up of two variants or modifications of the same generic type of fiber. So two variants of the same gene of fiber, generic fiber, same general fiber is known as the bicomponent fibers. And what is a biconstituent fiber? It is composed of two different generic fiber types. So the fiber genes are different. The fiber general fibers are different here. So that becomes the biconstituent, and the general fibers are same. That becomes the bicomponent fibers. Let's talk about some other properties wherein the physical shape, density and color comes. So let's talk about the physical shape. So what all comes in the physical shape? The fiber length, the surface, how the surface contour is, the irregularities. Whenever you're touching a fiber, maybe there are some irregularities, or what the cross-sectional shape of the fiber is. These all come in the physical shape. Let's talk about density. What is density? The relative weight of a fiber when it is compared with either water, or you can call it mass per unit volume, is the density of the fiber. Specific gravity. What is specific gravity? It is the relative weight per unit volume of the fiber. So nylon and acrylic have a low density and therefore they are light in weight, but cotton and rayon have high density. Next, like I told you, let's talk about the color. So like if you see cotton, so cotton is of many different types of white colors. It can be pure white, it can be creamy, it can be off-white, it can be gray. Man-made fibers. When we talk about man-made fibers, they are pure white in nature. Okay, let's talk about now moisture regain. So what is moisture regain in a fabric? Okay, each and every fabric has some amount of moisture that is there inside the fiber itself. So it is the certain amount of water which is present as an integral part of the fiber. And how is it expressed? It is expressed as the percentage of the weight of the moisture-free fiber. That is the moisture regain. Moisture absorption. Students, what is moisture absorption? See, whenever you immerse any cloth in liquid, or maybe whenever you wet any cloth, some absorb moisture very quickly and some do not absorb moisture. So what is this moisture absorption? The moisture absorbed at saturation point. Saturation point ka matlab uske beyond ab wo moisture absorb nahi kar sakta. So the moisture absorbed at saturation point is the moisture absorption. The better the moisture absorption, more is the absorption of dyes and finishes. So, pehle jab hum kisi bhi kapde ko, whenever we dye a cloth or maybe bleach a cloth, we will first see how much moisture it can absorb. If the cloth does not absorb any moisture, that means you cannot dye it at all, right? So, it is important that you have to see how much moisture absorption is. So the better the moisture absorption, more is the absorption of the dyes and the finishes. Rayon has low wet strength, but cotton has high wet strength. Now what we talk about strength, when you wet cotton cloth, it becomes strength, its strength increases, it becomes more much more in strength. But when you talk about rayon, its strength decreases while it is wet. We talk about next, the property that we are going to talk about is the elastic recovery and elongation. So what is elastic recovery and elongation? Let's talk about elongation first. Elongation is the amount of stretch that a fiber accepts when you pull it. Whatever the elongation is, the amount of stretch that a fiber accepts. And breaking elongation, what is breaking elongation? It is the amount of stretch that a fiber undergoes to the point where it breaks. It can be only stretched to a certain point after which it breaks. So that is the breaking elongation of that fiber. Elastic recovery. What is elastic recovery? Elastic recovery indicates the percentage of return from elongation to its original length. So what is elastic recovery? You have pulled a fiber. You've pulled a fiber and it has, it's elastic. Because of its elastic, it has been elongated. And when you leave it, the fiber comes back to its original length. So how much original length does it come back to is denoted by its elastic recovery. Now students, let's come to one more property, which is the flammability and other thermal reactions. Flammability, that word flammability comes from flames, yani ki aag. Matlab kaun sa kapda ya kaun sa fiber jo hai अच्छा मॉइस्चर अब्सॉर्ब कर देता है, उतना ही वो पुअर कंडक्टर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिसिटी और जब उसको आग से जो है वो उतना बचाव दे सकता है. सो व्हेन फाइबर हैज गुड मॉइस्चर अब्सॉर्बेंसी, इट विल बी अ पुअर कंडक्टर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिसिटी. फॉर एग्जांपल कॉटन सिंथेटिक फाइबर्स. If you've ever, you know, brought a synthetic fiber against a flame, जब उसको जलाया हो, तो आप देखेंगे कि they shrink, एकदम से वो जो है, जब सिकुड़ जाते हैं, and they start melting. लेकिन जो cellulosic fibers होते हैं, cellulosic मतलब कौन से हो गए? Natural fibers made of cells. Cellulosic fibers, they keep burning and they keep falling. जल जल के गिरते रहते हैं, सिकुड़ते नहीं हैं, melt नहीं होते हैं. ये हो गया फ्लैमेबिलिटी. और फिर हम बात करते हैं, लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ अ फैब्रिक. सो व्हाट इज द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ अ फैब्रिक? व्हेन यू टेयर अ फैब्रिक, सम फैब्रिक्स टेयर अप वेरी इजिली, बट सम फैब्रिक्स डू नॉट टेयर इजिली. सो दैट इज वेयर द स्ट्रेंथ प्रॉपर्टी कम्स. सो व्हाट इज स्ट्रेंथ? इट इज द रेजिस्टेंस अबिलिटी टू स्ट्रेस एंड स्ट्रेन, और it is expressed as the tensile strength, which is measured in PSI. What is PSI? Pounds per square inch. Or tenacity, the tensile strength can be measured in grams per denier. So when you wet cotton, it gains strength. Like I told you, जब आप भिगाते हैं cotton के कपड़े को, तो आप आसानी से नहीं फाड़ सकते हैं. So when cotton is wet, it gains strength. But when wool is wet, it loses its strength. Dacron and Orlon, the fibers which we will be talking about later, they are unaffected. Now let's talk about the abrasion resistance. Abrasion resistance क्या होता है? जब आप किसी भी fiber को, when you are rubbing it or giving it any kind of, you know, abrasions along with it, then the fiber, the ability of a fiber to withstand that abrasion or rubbing is called abrasion resistance. And when we talk about clothes which are for daily use, then we have to see that this abrasion resistance property should be there, because in the daily use, especially for children, they keep running, they keep crawling, and there is this property, there it comes into act. Next, we talk about the cohesiveness. What is cohesiveness? Clinging together. Aapas mein chipakna. The ability of fibers to cling together is known as cohesiveness. And this cohesiveness is important to staple those short fibers only. Loft, like I told you, resiliency. We had told about it later in the previous talk that we were talking about. There is one more word which is known as wicking or wetting. What is wicking or wetting? This refers to the conduction of moisture along the fiber or through the fabric. Whenever you have a fabric, for example, like if you have a cotton fabric and there is a certain amount of water, so aap jab us cotton fabric ko, when you put it over the water, you will see that it absorbs the water, and this term is known as wicking or wetting. It is the conduction of moisture along the fiber through the fabric. ठीक है, कैसे कैसे वो फैब्रिक पे फैलता जाता है वो मॉइस्चर, कैसे कैसे आगे बढ़ता जाता है, इट इज कॉल्ड द विकिंग और वेटिंग. दिस प्रॉपर्टी इज रिलेटेड टू सरफेस वेटिंग एंड इट इज नॉट द सेम एज अब्सॉर्बेंसी. अब्सॉर्बेंसी इज डिफरेंट, विकिंग और वेटिंग इज डिफरेंट. नेक्स्ट वी टॉक अबाउट द प्लास्टिसिटी ऑफ द फाइबर. द प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ अ फाइबर विच इनेबल्स द यूजर to shape it either semi-permanently or permanently by using either moisture, by using pressure, or by using heat is known as the plasticity of a fiber. And the last property, which is very important because fibers are selected according to that, also the fabric is selected according to that, is the resistance of the fiber to moths, mildew, and silverfish. Basically, the natural fibers, bacterial action also takes place. They start, the moths, the mildews, they start eating the fiber. So they are important because the chemical composition of the fiber is also a very important factor which comes into act when we talk about the resistance.